travel back in time to the 80s, reliving the advice.
Carpe diem. Seize the day.
The comebacks.
Why don't you take a picture? It'll last longer.
And the technology.
Are you telling me that you built a time machine? Out of a DeLorean?
Because just like you, we're stuck in the 80s.
Can you say stuck in the 80s?
I can't stand the rain against my window, bringing back sweet memories. I can't stand the rain against my window.
Hey, hey, welcome to Stuck in the 80s. It's your host, Steve Spears.
And Brad in LA.
And today we revisit our series on unlikely cover songs of the 80s with an all-female lineup of artists.
You know what an older woman does for me?
Changes your diapers.
Tush.
Stuck in the 80s is supported by the 80s Cruise. Join Spearsy and me on the Royal Caribbean Mariner of the Seas in March 2022 for an amazing trip back in time. Headliners for the cruise that week include The Human League, ABC, 38 Special, Berlin, Morris Day and the Time, Belinda Carlisle, Dire Straits Legacy, Modern English, John Parr, and many more. Use the promo code STUCK when booking to get $200 in cabin credit. But do it soon. The cruise has fewer than 10 cabins left for sale. Go to www.the80scruise.com for more details.
I am the monarch of the sea.
Hey, everybody. It's Steve and Brad.
Woohoo!
And what are we whacked up on today? I've been drinking lots of Aquafina. I'm still in New York, and I'm still on my soda ban and still trying to drink only wine during weekdays.
So nice.
I can't promise an even podcast performance today.
You are hanging on by a very thin thread. And I dig that about you.
Well, we'll dig deep. We'll find something for you. I myself am sitting here in the chair while inside my body a battle is raging as my immune system learns to fight the COVID.
Sounds like a subdural hematoma to me.
Oh, it does it? Well, it's not your job to diagnose.
But I thought.
You thought. Just go.
That's right. You got a shot today.
I did. And you'd go. You don't know what you're going to get. And I got the Johnson & Johnson. So not only did I give my first shot, I got my only shot. I'm done.
Isn't that weird that, like, you go to get the shot and you don't know what kind of shot you're going to get?
It's a little strange, but, you know, I think somebody said, I've seen this several places, the best vaccine is the one that's available when you sit down in the chair, and you know what? I'm okay with that.
I'm trying to get an appointment for next week when I'm back in Florida. It's tough. I mean, in Florida now, it's pretty much open to everybody. But the system for scheduling appointments is... I don't know. It's pretty much akin to the voting system for the Rock Hall of Fame. Nobody really understands it. Everyone's just basically unhappy about it.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of the U2 tour where they were selling tickets on the phone only, and you could only buy two tickets. And, you know, I was sitting at my desk just redial. And it's the same kind of thing. I was just, they announced that, you know, our age group was eligible in California, I just started getting on and going to, like, different pharmacy sites and refresh. And I managed to get an appointment, but it was, you know, I don't know how people who don't sit in front of a computer where they can just pivot to the internet for a few minutes now and then do this. It's got to be hard.
Anywho.
Anyway, enough about my vaccination status, which I know is fascinating to you all.
We had this series going for a while where we talked about songs from the 80s that we didn't realize were covers. And we've probably done, I don't know, 7 installments of it over the years.
I can't even tell you what the number is. But yeah, 7's a good number. I like that number.
And we have this, like, Google Doc where we look at it and we try to keep track of what we've covered so we don't cover it over and over again.
Did you know Gloria by Laura Branigan's a cover? Yes, I did.
Yes, Steve. Don't start me on that story. But here's why we're doing it this week. So last weekend, HBO debuted the new documentary about Tina Turner, and it's just called Tina. And I think it's about 2 hours long, maybe 2.5 hours long.
Okay, so it's like a single – it's not like an episodic
No, like, and it's not a bio drama. There's nobody playing Tina Turner. It is a straightforward documentary.
Okay.
And it
goes nice.
It goes all the way back to, you know, her growing up in Tennessee and hooking up with Ike Turner. I mean, the whole first half of the movie is Ike and Tina Turner, and then the whole second half of the movie is after she moved on in the late 70s. But let me just say this. I've always admired Tina Turner. You know, I don't think I ever owned her albums, but you didn't need to because it was always on the radio
and
always on TV.
Yeah.
But until you see this documentary, you'll never truly appreciate her. It is phenomenal. It is riveting. You can't turn it off.
Okay. I mean, that's high praise indeed. I will put it on the watch list for me and the long-suffering Mrs. Williams.
What is it, Peg? Oh,
it's just the love.
But the one takeaway I had as we were watching it was, my God, she does a lot of cover songs. She didn't write her own stuff, as far as I can tell. People wrote her songs.
Yeah.
So she had songwriters who were writing songs, you know, and offering them to whomever. And, you know, sometimes
– just trying to shop it around.
Sometimes she got it first. Sometimes she got it third. But what you realize when you watch this documentary is that, I mean, all the songs that you associate with, that's a Tina Turner song. Well, I mean, not so much. So what we're going to do is we are going to have an all-female edition of the Covers podcast today. But two of the songs, the first and the last, will both be Tina Turner songs, you know, as a tribute to that amazing documentary, and because it just kind of blows my mind that so many songs that I just think of as that is hers.
Right.
It turns out it really wasn't. So, ready to get started?
Let's do this thing.
Let's see our first category. Ladies of the 80s.
Here's our first Tina Turner song. Oh, what's love got to do? It's got to do with what's love but a second-hand emotion? What's love got to do? It's got to do with it. Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken? There's nothing more distinctively her than what's love got to do with it.
Yeah. Again, this is one of those... That's a cover? No.
Well, here we get into a little bit of murkiness.
Well, but that's okay. We've murked before.
Yeah. So most people know that this song comes off her album Private Dancer from 1984. It is her most successful single.
Oh.
It was her first and only number one song on the Hot 100.
Okay.
She's retired now. So, you know, I think... You know, safe to say she's not going to – unless some of this music makes a comeback as a result of the documentary,
yeah,
which wouldn't shock me.
That could be. Sure. That's been known to happen.
Anyway, at the time that this came out, she was 44 years old. She was the oldest solo female artist to top the top 100 chart.
Oh, my gosh. I'd bite your arm off to be 44 years old.
It did amazing. It won 3 awards at the Grammys in 85. It got Record of the Year, Song of the Year, which I never understood that whole silliness, but
maybe some musician can come on and explain that to us. Yeah.
Oh, gee, I don't know. Someone actually came on our podcast as a guest. That's just so verboten these days. And it also won Best Female Pop Vocal Performance. So
nice.
And if you're thinking, you know, I kind of, what else? Wasn't there a film that used that as a title? Yeah. There was a 1993 film. I think Angela Bassett played.
Right. Okay. Okay. I wasn't imagining that.
Yeah.
Kind of knocking around the back corner of my brain there.
By the way, there's this really awkward moment in the documentary. When that movie comes out, they're doing a press event, and Angela and Tina Turner are sitting right next to each other at the press table.
Okay.
And the first question is, you know, asking Tina what she thought of the movie. She says, I haven't watched it. And like, why not? She's like, well, it includes a lot of stuff about a period of my life that frankly I don't want to revisit, and you know, going through it once was enough.
Oh, see, she should have just pulled out the Pee Wee Herman. I don't have to watch it. I lived it.
But you could just the look on Angela's face sitting next to her just is like, like, you know, pucker time. I mean, just that horrible, I'm trying to smile, but inside my soul is dying.
What the heck just happened here? Yeah, that has to be, that has to be really strange to be playing a living person who is well known and have them sitting at the table next to you. Like, I pretended to be you. Like, yeah. Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, how lovely. So you actually had a man beat on you for half your life? No, I just pretended
Oh, well, call me after you've been beaten.
Yeah. I'm not trying to belittle. I'm not trying to make a joke out of domestic violence.
No, it's got to be a very surreal experience on both sides of the coin.
It's just a weird. I mean,
that's why I shot down the Steve Spears, Brad Williams movie, you know, about our lives. It just,
until Jim Belushi agrees to play me, I'm just not going to agree to it. So.
Oh, no, there's an interesting segue. Cast the podcast. Who would you cast?
I think the only person who could play herself would be Jen with one N. I just don't see anybody stepping forward and being able to handle that. So,
yeah, it's hard to say.
Anyway,
so sorry. Off on the tangents goes Brad.
The point being, it was a cover song. It was written by a songwriting duo named Terry Britton and Graham Lyle. And they offered it to Cliff Richard, but he said no. And I believe it was offered to a couple other people before finally a British pop group called Bucks Fizz were offered it. And Bucks Fizz is just has an odd little history, doesn't it, Brad?
Oh my gosh. If you want drama with your music, then these guys are your guys. And they're not all guys. These people are your people. So the band was kind of formed for I think it was formed for the Eurovision Song Contest in 1981, which our European listeners will know a little bit better than maybe they know some of the commercials we talked about last week, but they'll know about Eurovision. The only connection I have to Eurovision is, you know, ABBA won it a million years ago, and Steve and I have interviewed a Eurovision Song Contest winner in Katrina from Katrina.
Katrina.
And she could not have been nicer. Oh my gosh. I love Katrina. She's fantastic.
She's on my list of, I don't care where she is in the state I'm in. If she's performing, I'm going to find a way to go.
Yeah. So they had, like, just look over their Wikipedia page and there's like car crashes and bad injuries and people sleeping with other people's spouses and just backstabbing craziness. And oh, they're a quartet. No, now they're a trio. Now they're back to a quartet. It's crazy. Like, there should be a movie of this.
I don't know if people are going to buy a ticket to see it. I'd like to see the Bucks Fizz story.
I think you're going to have to rename it to Strong Mimosa, which is basically what a Bucks Fizz is. It's a mimosa with one part orange juice and two parts champagne instead of one and one.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the group did record it. It was sung by a male instead of a female, and it sounds like this. What's love got to do with it? What's love but second-hand emotion? What's love got to do with it? Who needs a heart when a heart can be broken? Not all that different, just kind of a different, I don't know, beat.
The male lead really changes the tone of the song, I think.
Yeah.
I feel like, you know, I mean, yes, we're all so familiar with the Tina Turner version, but I think it's demonstrably better and suits the material better in spite of the producer saying, oh, this, you can't have a woman sing this song. Yeah, how's that working out for you, champ?
Yeah. So, Bucks Fizz, I still can't say the name without just feeling like I've swallowed a fly.
Just makes you smile.
They were going to put it on their next album. I don't know how many albums they had, but let's just assume they had more than one. But it was shelved because Tina actually was able to get her version out first. So is it a cover song? They did record it first. Tina heard their version.
Okay.
But
I mean, that's the same rationale we used for Girls Just Want to Have Fun.
Yes.
So I say it qualifies.
It qualifies. Well, we just recorded it and put it into a show, and we're not redoing it.
Ergo. QED. We move on.
Speaking of another iconic female artist of the 80s, Cher had a cover song in the 80s, and this is it. To take away the heartache. idea that I found someone was a cover song. If there's anything that screams Cher in the 80s, it's this one.
Yeah, it's funny because from the title, I mean, okay, look, full disclosure, did Brad ever own any Cher records? No, Brad did not. I'm like, I found someone. I don't think I recognize that. Is that the one with the auto-tune? I'm like, no, they didn't have auto-tune.
No, that's If You Believe
life,
in Love.
Or Life After Love or Death After Life or I don't know. Anyway, so I really didn't recognize this from the title, and I heard it, and I'm like, yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is a Cher song. I recognize it. And then I got to do a little research, which we do sometimes try to do for you fine listeners. This is a chart single that was originally written for Laura Branigan by Michael Bolton. Oh, man, so much cheese in one song. And touch keyboardist Mark Mangold. So I feel like he's done other stuff. I didn't connect that name with any more dots right now.
Let's listen to the Laura Branigan song. Okay. Here's something interesting, too. If it sounds like there's a familiar arrangement to it, credit Harold Faltermeyer, because he helped produce it and he arranged it. So there you go.
Nice. I mean, this when you hear Laura's version, again, it's not terribly different, but you can, you know, the compare and contrast between the two is mainly what I think you get is Cher's voice just, I can't believe I'm going to say this, it's more soulful. There's, I don't know if it's just the range that she's in or the tenor of her voice is different. It's a little deeper and it just, it feels more, there's more emotion in it to me.
Yeah. It has, I know you like to talk about the videos and this one I did actually sit down and watch because I had read that her then boyfriend, Rob Camilletti,
yeah, who was like 14 years old, right?
Yeah, something like that. He was 17 years younger than she was.
Yeah.
And he wanted to be an actor, and this was his big debut.
Don't we all?
I don't think. You know,
heck, that's right. We really want to direct. I'm sorry. That's what we really want.
Every once in a while, I used to always ask the question, and I think it's a revealing question, and we'll get back to Rob here in a second. But like, if I gave you a choice of how you were going to be achieve fame, would you rather do it as a musician, an author, or an actor?
I tend to think at this point in my life, being an author would be the easiest on me personally.
Well, I mean, you could frame the question however you want. You could go. I'm saying.
Well, I'm answering it right now. Right now, I would be an author because I see that. Would I love touring for the rest of my life? I don't know. So I'm going to go with author.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm
a big fan
of... I
could go on my book tour. I could sign some books. And I could go back home and people leave me alone.
I think I would go with musician. I like a good sandwich tray.
Okay. Yeah. You know what? There's another Seggy. Write Steve's concert writer.
It'd have a lot of ice cold Gatorade. And a lot of sandwich trays.
What about Skittles? Would there be Skittles?
No, I don't. I'm not really much of a candy fan. So anyway, back to Rob.
Back to Cher and Rob.
So I was watching the video, and I wanted to watch it to catch a glimpse of the would-be actor, but I couldn't because he was basically obscured by what appeared to be a planet-sized version of Cher's hair. I have never I love big hair.
There's a lot of hair in that video.
I love big hair in the 80s. I really do. But Cher puts it to the test. I mean, it's just like – it's comic. It looks – it's like it's some sort of campy display. It's that.
Do you think it's a wig?
No, but I believe that probably a gigantic –
several refineries worth of petroleum were required to
– Exactly. So anyway, oh my God.
That's crazy. This was released by Cher as the first – single from her 18th album in 1987. This was produced by Michael Bolton, who, as you may remember from earlier, before two diversions ago, he helped write and compose the song, and it made it to number 10. Not bad, Cher.
Yeah. Well, I mean, she owned the late 80s. I mean, both yeah. as an actress and as a singer.
Yeah, this was a big musical comeback for her when she was doing a lot of really kind of well-considered acting. You know, she had done some really good work on the screen, and this was a chance for her to say, hey, guys, I still do this, too.
You got a personal favorite as far as Cher movies go?
No.
I'm going to go with Mask.
Yeah, probably Mask, but I'm like, let's see, what else is there? There's Mask. There's
Moonstruck.
Moonstruck. There's Mermaids. Isn't she in Mermaids?
Yeah. I think she was in Police Academy 5.
Oh, well, then put me down for Police Academy 5. Nothing against Cher. I think she does good work in all those movies. They're just not anything that I'm like, let's sit down and watch Moonstruck. As famously as known on the podcast, I've seen Moonstruck exactly once, and that was before we did our Moonstruck episode.
I find that just, I don't know, entertaining. I guess it was only a fluke that I saw it because that was like the late 80s. And I think it might have been the year that I literally went and watched every movie that was nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah. I mean, it was okay. I didn't dislike it. I just don't have any connection to the source material. So that's fine.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, I keep walking around New York waiting for to bump into any of the scenes from Moonstruck. Yeah. But I don't think I'm in the right part of town.
We'll get you a map.
I don't know. The only thing that's on this block, really, that you can see out the window is there's two vaping shops.
No Dwayne Reed? Are you sure you're in New York if you can't see a Dwayne Reed?
There's no Dwayne Reed here. I'd never even heard of Dwayne Reed until I started coming to New York. And then,
isn't that funny? They're everywhere.
They are, but the ones that are nearest to me are Walgreens and CVS, which is like, that's so boring. We have those in Florida. But I still haven't been in a Dwayne Reed.
Well, it's everything you would hope for in a major chain drugstore.
I haven't been in the vape shops either. They scare the hell out of me.
Yeah, well, that makes sense.
By the way, they legalized recreational marijuana here.
Okay.
This week.
Wow. So, is Pot Alley going like bananas? Are they lighting off fireworks down there?
You know, it's funny. I go to Pot Alley every day to walk the dog. And I walked just before the podcast. Pot Alley doesn't smell like Pot Alley anymore. But every other part, like I got on the elevator to come back upstairs and it reeked of pot.
Huh.
I don't have anything against marijuana. I don't, I haven't smoked it since like college.
Right.
But, and I've never ingested it or, you know, like done the hash brownies or whatever they call them, whatever the kids call them.
Kids are doing these days.
I don't have any objection to it. I just choose not to do it because.
Sure. It's not your Jimmy Jam.
Yeah, but the one thing I object to is, man, it is the it's so pungent. Like, there's just no like, oh, were you smoking in here? If you were smoking pot, there's like, it's not a question. It's like,
did a skunk die in here?
It's so bad. We're all over the place today. This is what happens.
We kind of are. This is what happens when we record at the end of a day.
Yeah. Or the whole point is that, you know, obviously my weekday drinking ban is paying off in some parts of my life, but not on the podcast portion of it.
Well, Steve, isn't this our time?
I don't know. I don't know. All I know is there better be pizza for dinner when this is all over.
Ooh, pizza. Anyway, that sounds good.
We're halfway through.
Moving on.
Juice Newton had a cover in the 80s. This one probably not too shocking. Let's hear it. Angel of the Morning, well-known song. I don't know. This is one of those songs where it's like, well, did you know it was a cover? It's like, I know the song. I don't think I ever knew that it was a Juice Newton song.
You didn't know this was a Juice Newton song?
I don't know. I mean, it wasn't like I didn't have the 45 of this at home. I know you didn't.
No, I certainly didn't. But
boy, we're coming across as a couple of clods in this
episode.
That's
okay. We you know, we're equal opportunity offenders.
Anyway,
let me just say, I really like this song.
It's fantastic.
I think Juice Newton has a great voice, and this is a great song. I think if I'm having to pick a favorite Juice Newton song, is this in the top five? But it's a great song. It doesn't surprise me that it's a cover just because she's more of a country musician, and there's just a lot of kind of cross-pollinization in country, right? So
sure.
you're not so surprised that, you know, oh, they also did a version of, you know, She Got the Gold Mine and I Got the Shaft, or, you know, whatever it may be.
Yeah. When I was doing the research for this, I started to wonder, because I think we've talked about Juice Newton on the show, you know, once or twice, but I don't think we ever – I never really delved into the mystery of, like, why the nickname Juice.
Yeah.
I can't find a really great answer for it other than it was just a nickname she got picked – that her family gave her when she was growing up.
Nice.
But one thing that's interesting was that when she got into a career of music, music execs were telling her to drop it and go back to her given name of Judy.
No. Music executives are idiots. Juice. Yeah. Stick with juice. The juice is loose. Oh, wait. That's a different juice.
Anyway, Angel of the Morning was written and composed by a songwriter named Chip Taylor. And he wrote a lot of songs for artists. Probably best known for, Wild Thing. Which, for some reason, you almost have to sing it when you say it. Wild Thing.
Steve, you make my heart sing.
If you're an Ace Frehley fan, Chip Taylor also wrote Rock Soldiers for the former Kiss guitarist.
Okay. Is that the lead single from his second, third, or fourth album?
I don't think I ever owned any Ace Frehley albums, except the solo album that all the Kiss members did, you know, where they had their – I think it was late 70s that they did that.
Nice.
I had the Ace Frehley one, and I had the Gene Simmons.
Frehley's Comet? Wasn't there Frehley's Comet?
Something like that. Anyway – Angel in the Morning was recorded by a lot of people, not just Juice Newton. For some reason, I'm having trouble saying that. Mary Lee Rush, P.P. Arnold, Connie Eaton, Olivia Newton-John. But probably the best version is the one by Mary Lee Rush, and it sounds like this.
Just call me Angel of the Morning, Angel. Just touch my cheek before you leave.
Nice. Very similar. Not too far of a stray from...
Yeah, when was that recorded? Because that has a very... I mean, it's just, again, it's time and place, some of the instrumentation in it and the way that it's scored and like the little percussion touches and things. It kind of puts it in a time and place. It sounds very, very 60s.
Yes, exactly. Angel of the Morning would get Mary Lee Rush a Grammy Award nomination for this record.
Sweet.
Look who she was up against, though. She was up against Barbara Streisand for Funny Girl, Dionne Warwick for Do You Know the Way to San Jose.
Oh, my gosh.
Aretha Franklin for I Say a Little Prayer, and Mary Hopkin for Mary Hopkin for Those Were the Days. Dionne Warwick won, by the way.
That's one of those, I'm just happy to be nominated. I can't believe I'm in such amazing company. You go to the dinner, and you look around, and you shake everyone's hand, and you're like, well, that was something.
Yeah. Maybe decades from now, a couple of fine lads will do a podcast about me. So. Anyway, as we promised, we were going to book in the show with two Tina Turner songs. Here was another song that, no surprise, this is a cover.
What?
This is I Can't Stand the Rain. I Can't Stand the Rain was off Private Dancer, same as the first song. It was originally recorded by Ann Peebles back in 1973. And there was other versions recorded by Eruption and Lil George. Here's Ann Peebles' version. According to the story that I've read, one evening in Memphis, like all good stories start with the lines.
If you start your sentence that way, you know it's going to be good.
Ann Peebles was was meeting friends, including her partner, High Records staff writer Don Bryant, to go to a concert. And just as they were about to head off to the show, it just started pouring rain. Okay. And people just kind of like snapped and said, I can't stand the rain. And as a professional songwriter who was constantly yearning for new material.
Yeah, got to turn out a new podcast this week. I mean, got to write a new song this week.
Don Bryant, his habit was to find resonant phrases, that he would pluck out of the air and turn them into songs. And so, boom, I Can't Stand the Rain becomes a song. So there you go.
Puts on our napkin. I have to say, when I saw this in the rundown, I'm like, please be a cover of Orange Juice Jones's song, The Rain. Please, please, please.
No.
It is not, much to my chagrin. I really wanted to hear Tina Turner talk about some hush puppy wearing crumb cake, but that didn't happen.
It would go on and become people's biggest hit. It got to number 38 on the charts. When Tina Turner recorded it in 1984 for Private Dancer, it was released as a single in Europe mainly.
Okay.
It would get successful over there. It never really resonated with U.S. audiences. But, I mean, it's a pretty much a standard inclusion on her set lists for her shows. If you really want an earworm, my God, when I was doing the notes for this, I walked around for like 3 days going, I can't stand the rain. So it's
which is why we close with it, to punish you as Steve has been punished.
You know what else would be kind of punishing this week? The Seggies. It's time for I Want My Mystery TV Theme Song. Well, I guess it is. I have nothing else to say.
That's what it says right here on the sheet. That must be true.
It just says, I Want My Mystery TV Theme Song. We will play a snippet of a theme song from the 80s. If you get it right, you're entered into the drawing for the Postal Friendly Bottle Opener.
Oh, I love the way you say that.
Yeah, that one came out interesting. It didn't feel as good, I gotta admit. I don't know what's wrong with me today. It's the Aquafina. The water.
Some days are
the...
better than others.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't stand the rain. I can't sing. I don't know if you knew that about me.
I hear you do a great job of Funky Cold Medina.
It's the only thing I can do. You'll hear
it's
it on the
got
cruise.
That gravelly voice.
Pay attention. Here was the clip from the last time we did this Seggy. That's American Gladiators.
What a great choice. What a great choice, dude. I love this.
Trying to mix it up a little bit. It barely comes in. I think American Gladiators came on in 1989.
Just glances the decade. A glancing blow. And set the stage for such silliness later, like Wipeout, which is the opposite of American Gladiators. It's like American doofuses. But you can't not watch it because it's just like...
I don't.
People getting bonked in the face and stuff. It's just absolute lowbrow comedy. But
I don't have regular TV anymore. All I have is the streaming services.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't get live TV. So there's no temptation for me really to watch any of the today's programming. So all I do is watch Hulu, Amazon Prime, Netflix.
I do have some news for you, Steve. There are new programs that are showing up on all of those platforms.
Yeah,
some of them
know,
made specifically for those platforms.
I just don't. I watched Schitt's Creek. I watched, but that was actually on Pop TV. So I don't want to get on an anti-TV rant, but it's one of those things I just don't.
There's some new stuff out there that I think is really good. Okay. I don't know if you've seen Ted Lasso.
I have not.
Oh, it's hilarious. And it just has so much heart. You think it's going to be this kind of one joke series about, oh, look, a soccer team in England hired an American football coach to be their coach. He doesn't know anything about soccer. And you're like, okay, this is going to be the same joke every, it's just going to be fish out of water all the way through. But there's a lot more to it than that. Give it a look if you've got Apple TV Plus.
Oh, it's Apple TV Plus. Well, I don't have that. So
I got a new iPad and it came with a subscription. So I'm like, okay, we'll give it a look.
Anyway, we did have some winners who got it right. Why don't you read some names?
Oh, here we go. Winners this week include Joseph Perdue, Crispy Critter, Gene and Hollister, Tom Korn in Austria, Dave Estel, Rick and Kenosha, Brian Pond, Alan B., Tommy Doucette, Mike from the Sloats, Dave in Oxford, Chris Deep Cut Sampson, Matt D. in Oregon, John in L.A. Center, Kentucky, Sal from Buffalo, and Dave in an undisclosed location. Here's my coded message to you, Dave, in an undisclosed location. Postal-friendly bottle opener in mail today.
Good. I was going to say, he finally had to disclose the location, or else he wasn't going to get his...
But I'm not sharing that with you, gentle listener. Oh, no. That would be a serious breach of trust.
Okay, spin the wheel. Let's find out who gets a postal-friendly bottle opener.
Here we go.
Looks like it's going to land on Dave in Oxford. You're this week's winner. So email us your postal address, mailing address, whatever address.
Off it goes.
And then check the mailbox daily, because you never know when a postal-friendly bottle opener might arrive. In the meantime, pay attention. Here's this week's mystery theme song. If you know it, email us at podcast@sit80s.com. Wow, the enunciation. Very rare for this point of the show. Normally, I'd be slurring my words and ordering dominoes.
Chair. You guys, you don't even know the thumps and bumps I have to edit out when he falls asleep in the middle.
You have to edit out when I start thumping my microphone stand, which I haven't touched today.
I try to do that, but most often you do it when you're talking, so I can't take it out.
I don't think anyone cares.
You get very excited and you use it to emphasize points. Well, bam. And another thing, Williams, you and this microphone stand suck.
This is the microphone stand that I use here. There's one in New York and there's one in Florida. The sure. one in New York, future wife uses it to keep the toaster oven door shut when she's toasting something. The toaster oven is so broken that it won't fully close. But if you take the microphone stand and jam it up against it, you can actually make toast.
Is that a coded request for something off of gift list for the wedding?
I don't think we registered for a toaster oven. I keep threatening to buy her one for here, but her kitchen's, you know, it's a New York kitchen. It's
right.
Space is at a premium.
It's so small you can barely change your mind in there.
Yes. You've got it nailed. Anyway, as you know, email us at podcast@sats.com and tune in soon to find out if you're a winner. We'll be right back after this commercial break.
I want to show you something. This is a Plymouth Acclaim. It's got so much room. It holds six big, gorgeous men. Now, this is something I like in a car.
Acclaim. First-class travel for the price of coach. From Plymouth.
That's right. Plymouth.
And we're back. And this is a weird thing we're going to do now. So, last week's show was about TV commercials that were earworms.
Right.
And I thought it was a good show. I enjoyed recording it, and I really enjoyed listening to the final product. But I guess at some point during the show, we talked about Missouri, the state of Missouri.
You threw a little shade.
Did I? Was it me? What did I say? I said I'd never been there.
You said Missouri, and it sounds a lot like misery.
Oh. Well, that the pronunciation does.
Yes.
I've never been there, but you have been there, and you said that it was spread out and flat.
Right? That's what the cities are like, yes.
Yes. So,
because I'm a city guy, apparently, and now I don't know anything about the country no more.
Yeah. So, oddly enough, we got a lot of feedback on that.
Yeah, Missouri Nation had some things to say.
Jim from Missouri wrote and said, okay, this is not something I typically do, but you need to be called out on something. Here it goes. The great state of Missouri is a very beautiful and awesome state. That is all, Jim.
Okay. Short and to the point. Love it.
You could have made a pitch for the toasted Ravs, I guess. That's really the only food item I know about. And our longtime friend, Kevin Serving Wench, wrote, and
I think you should let me read this one.
Okay.
Here we go. So Kevin wrote, first of all, Brad, The part of Missouri I live in is not flat, not by a long shot. I know you mentioned St. Louis and KC, and those northern parts might be more flat, but they don't call southwest Missouri the Ozarks for nothing. We are around the Ozark Mountains, and we've got hills aplenty. Come visit, and I'll show you. I think Dave Dirt, who grew up in Southwest City, about 45 miles or so from me, would agree. We are not all flat. We are definitely not A or B cup. Okay, Kevin, I'm going to set aside any problematic nature of using women's body parts to describe global topography, and I'm just going to make a few statistical observations. These are fact-based observations. The highest point in Missouri is 1,772 feet above sea level. That makes it the 41st lowest high point in the states of the United States. Ooh, really big there. Also, I'm looking out my window as I record this, and I see a peak that is four times that high from my boring suburban California house. Don't tell me how hilly you are, bro. End of rant.
Stick to the toasted Ravs. Anyway, we did get another email. This is really weird. From Michael Dodd from Australia, who says he didn't mind the Missouri slams, but he hated the past couple of episodes.
Oh.
He writes, "Hey guys, just providing some feedback in the most recent ads episode in the instrumental show. They were okay, but not really my cup of tea. I'm not a massive fan of instrumentals, and the first episode was from when I was 2 years old. I'm more into the 80s than the 70s.
Oh, Michael, just lord your young years over us like that.
He continues, "I'm from Australia." Is that very hilly, Brad?
Australia? I haven't really done my research there, but yeah, I don't know.
"I'm from Australia, so I barely knew any of the advertisements, as we have similar companies but with different ads." Okay.
Yeah.
"Sorry to be a Debbie Downer. I listen to the show religiously and love nearly everything you guys throw at us. Just not these."
I have to say, okay, I hadn't considered the fact that international listeners might be scratching their heads a little bit over the Kit Kat jingle.
No, I totally get that, Mike.
Yeah.
I remember I messaged Brad, or I may have even actually picked up the phone and called him. I was like, "Oh man, we totally brain farted on that one. You know, like, some of these commercials probably have never been seen outside the U.S. So anyway,
we're idiots.
It's a good point. As far as the instrumental thing goes, though, I mean, we weren't – the whole point is that we're trying to give you like an idea of – this is the music that led us into the 80s. I mean, it wasn't like, the room was dark and suddenly someone flipped on the light switch and there were the 80s. There was,
the knack
there was a transitional
springing
period
to life from the closet.
So, I mean, what we're trying to do, and we've done it in previous episodes too about the 70s, is we're trying to show
– like, this is the on-ramp. We're coming up to speed.
Right. I suspect what we're going to do with the instrumentals is we'll probably group them into like groups of years. So it'll be like, 1977 to 1980 or something like that.
I mean,
that,
we could find instrumentals from all of those years, but we may not be able to find instrumentals that are particularly interesting. So.
Right. Or ones
or
that are
notable.
Even
yeah.
Listen to. I mean, I was not into instrumentals either in the 80s. So go figure. Anyway, as far as our Missouri friends go, they got the last laugh because they subscribed us to a I Heart Missouri e-newsletter that we just got today. But Brad took care of that. No worries.
I'll tidy it up. No problem.
We find out who it was, we're going to subscribe you to a bedwetters one. I'm just saying. But hey, no harm. We're just having a little bit of fun. I mean, if you want, I can continue to just disparage the states of Ohio and Michigan. I got plenty more material for those.
We would be disappointed if you didn't, defend your homeland. You know, just like as the Beach Boys said, be true to your school.
Yeah. And just to show no hard feelings, here's a song by Johnny Cash. But in the meantime, Brad and I remain here, though not quite Missourians. Still, two regular guys who are just stuck in the 80s.
Way down in Missouri, where I heard this melody when I was a little fellow on my mammy's knee.
Stuck in the 80s is now on Patreon. If you'd like to support the show, go to patreon.com/stuckinthe80spodcast. Special thanks to Check Battery Daily for our theme music, and thanks for listening.
Hush-a-bye, my baby, go to sleep on daddy's knee. Journey back to Dixieland and dreams again with me.